was red flag? Red flag means the dangerous diagnosis, which can be life-threatening, which can cause the permanent damage, which can cause the paralysis, which can be making the patients bedridden. So we have to identify those red flag signs and symptoms. It can be by history. Always that will be giving the most important clues. Not only here, in every situation, remember, the most important thing for a pain physician is history. You have to take the history very nicely, and not only taking the history, you have to, you know, you have to analyze those history in a very much, you know, step by step, in an analytical way. So then only you will be able to come to a diagnosis. So here also, when you are evaluating the red flag, very important clues will be coming from red flag. Then little bit of examination, then little bit of investigations to rule out the red flag. Red flag means dangerous diagnosis. So I tell you, remember this way. One side is your trauma, tumor, fracture, infection. What kind of trauma? Major trauma. Just simply, you know, from chair you just fell down on the floor, it's not a major trauma. That is not a major trauma. So major trauma, accident or falling from height, distance. And if you are suspecting some fracture, like somebody is very osteoporotic, elderly people, even that the trigger trauma can produce fracture, but whether you are suspecting fracture or not, if you are having the history of major trauma, if you are suspecting the fracture, if you are suspecting infection, how to suspect infection? Patient might be having fever, patient might be having other kind of malaise, nausea. On examination, might be having the neck rigidity or dealing with the infection of the spine, of the central nervous system. So the neck rigidity guarding signs might be there. If you are doing up the total count, the count might be raised, ESS might be raised, by which you should be suspecting infection. So infection is a red flag. So trauma, tumor, if you are suspecting tumor, somebody elderly people, somebody having the, you know, the unexplained weight loss, or somebody is having the CA lung non presence with the back pain, you have every reason to understand that this can be having the metastasis in the vertebra. So if you are suspecting tumor, so these four: trauma, tumor, fracture, infection. And in other side, neurodeficits. What are the neurodeficits? Under three major reasons. One is your autonomic, another is your motor, another is your sensory. So most important is your autonomic. Very recently we have seen one, you know, patient who was having the bladder paralysis, only 7 days. But if he has done surgery by 2 days, the patient might not be having a different outcome. He was waiting, that you can remember that patient, his operation was done after 7 days, and by that time already the autonomic fibers has lost. So very important is to identify the red flag at the beginning, then only you can give a meaningful life to these patients. So autonomic fibers are most dangerous. Now question is, which autonomic fibers, when we are dealing with back pain, is it sympathetic fibers which will be damaged more, or parasympathetic fibers which will be damaged more, and why? You have to answer me based on the discussion of the sympathetic fibers anatomy in the morning. Which fibers are most likely to be damaged in back pain patients?
Sympathetic.
Why?
That's the relation of sympathetic chain close to the ventricle.
And parasympathetic? It is not sympathetic. It is parasympathetic. Why? Parasympathetic is craniosacral outflow. Craniosacral means 4 cranial nerves parasympathetic. Which cranial nerves? Do you remember?
379.
And also the sacral nerve. Which sacral? 2-3. Mostly 2-3. That's 4 also. That means these fibers are coming down through the lumbar, sacral, and then through the sacral nerve to their lung. And what happens to the sympathetic fibers? Last sympathetic fibers comes out of the spinal canal at the level of L2. After that, all sympathetic chain is outside the spinal canal, not inside the spinal canal. So if somebody is within a canal, they are much more vulnerable. vulnerable to damage because something is happening, you know. There is no room to go away. They cannot flee because their boundary is, you know, all around the Mooney canal. So somebody is compressing, some tumor, some hematoma, some prolapses. If they are compressing the canal, so these fibers will be easily damaged because they cannot flee away, they cannot go to the side. They will be compressed like in the Mooney canal. Whereas those fibers which are outside the canal, if something is pressing, they will be, you know, moving to the side. They will not be compressed against some rigid organ. That means sympathetic fibers are less likely to damage unless there is a cross injury which will be updating both the, you know, the sympathetic and parasympathetic fibers. But the commonest one, like a hematoma, like common, most common is your hugely prolapsed disc. So what will happen? They will be compressing the parasympathetic fibers and other cortical fibers, which are hanging, you know. Spinal cord has ended at the lower level of lower quarter of L1, and after that all the cortical fibers along with the parasympathetic fibers is going outside, so they will be damaged when the spinal canal is getting compromised, and this condition is called corda equina syndrome. So what is corda equina syndrome? Compression of the cortical fibers. How? An acute compression, not the chronic one. Chronic one have the different other symptomatology. Acute compression of the spinal canal damaging the cortical fibers is a cortical syndrome. So what are the commonest cause? Commonest cause is your hugely large prolapsed disc. This is the commonest one. The other one, then trauma causes hematoma, listhesis, acute listhesis because of the fracture, past fracture, or rapidly growing tumor. They are the other causes. But the commonest cause is your cortical syndrome, is your large prolapsed disc. Large disc material is coming out in the canal and the fibers cannot go outside, cannot move, so they are getting compressed. So all these fibers, sensory and motor fibers along the nerve root, along with the parasympathetic fibers, they will be damaged. Right? So what are the functions of the parasympathetic fibers? Mostly these are for the bladder and bowel. Other fibers are there, other function is there, but mostly bladder and bowel. So what are, if the parasympathetic fibers is damaged, will be taking over hand? Because it's a balance of sympathetic and parasympathetic. So if the parasympathetic is damaged, then the sympathetic will be taking upper hand. So we'll be discussing first to the bladder and then in the bowel. So the bladder, if the parasympathetic is damaged, sympathetic is taking over hand, what will be the symptom?
Retention.
Right. Why retention? The sphincter will be constricted by the parasympathetic fibers and rectus of muscle will relax so that there will be retention of the area. So if somebody is telling you, okay, hesitancy of the area, that is not because of the cortical syndrome. Cortical syndrome produces a retention of it. Right? Now what happens to the bowel? What will happen to the bowel? There will be constipation. There will be constipation. They will not be able to evacuate the blood. They will not be able to evacuate them. But if you are doing a parietal examinations, what will be your observation? Sphincter will be constricted or sphincter will be relaxed? You should remember that in the caudal syndrome, the very important clinical test is your pararectal examinations for two reasons: to look for the perianal anesthesia and to look for the sphincter tone. This is very, very important. Any patient when you are suspecting the cortical syndrome, you must do a pararectal examinations for these two purposes: perianal anesthesia and sphincter tone. So what will be the sphincter tone? Increased or decreased? 10? It should be increased, isn't it? Constriction of the sphincter and relaxation of the muscles of the sphincter will be increased, isn't it? Sphincter should be increased. Yes, it should be increased. But it is the internal anal sphincter which tone will be increased. You have to remember that in the bowel there are two sphincters. One is internal anal sphincter and another is external. The external anal sphincter tone is controlled by the, it is a skeletal muscle. It is supplied by the motor fibers. It's a voluntary muscle. that sphincter tone will be decreased. You can easily do a parietal examination. Your four fingers, five fingers will be easily able to do the parietal examinations. But the internal sphincters, which is controlled by the autonomic, sympathetic and parasympathetic, that will be constricted. Because what will happen? Patient will not be able to pass the stool easily. And like we have seen this patient very recently. So this patient was, you know, need to do the catheterization, self-catheterization, and also manual evacuation of the stool. He was unable to pass the stool. So this is happening for the last few years, young, you know, around in 30s patient. He was having the problem for 7 days only. And after 7 days he was underwent the surgery. But surgery was unable to correct this deficit. Why? Because if the parasympathetic fibers are damaged, the surgical decompression must be done within 2 days, 48 hours. After that, the chance of the recovery of these nerves, classical, you know, those who have seen these patients will always remember what happens, how dangerous is the cortical syndrome. You know. Immediately you have to get care. Otherwise, after 2 days, the chances of the recovery is removed. Okay, so this is most dangerous. So retention and constipation, unable to pass the thing. Though there is perianal anesthesia, though the sphincter tone is relaxed, still patient is unable to wipe the stool. Now, second is motor. Motor is also dangerous, but not as dangerous as parasympathetic. Motor, how it will be manifested? Paralysis, weakness. So you can divide by the weakness, grades of weakness. Motor power, zero. No flicker, one. Some flickers, but no contraction, reasonable contraction of the limb. Then, contraction of the limb is, gravity is eliminated, that means on the bed. Grade 3, against gravity, but not against resistance. Grade 4, against quick, mild resistance. And grade 5, none. So, grade 4, or very mild motor weakness is not considered as red. But more than that is red. And there, you have to decompress the nerve quickly. But again, little time is there. Best results are seen if decompression is done within 4 weeks. So, compared to that of the cordaguna, this is also dangerous, but not as dangerous as the cordaguna. For the cordaguna, should decompress within 2 days. Here, you are getting 28 days. But again, remember that it is not the 28 days is, you know, this thing, 29 days will not be having. It's not like that. It gradually pass off. That means even after two weeks of, you know, very nice surgery, your motor power may not regain. And even after 2 months of the surgery, motor power may be fully regained. So it is not that, but it's a rough estimate that we should be taking every effort that it is surgically decompressed, not or decompressed within 4 weeks. And the last one is your sensor, which has been given the least importance. Sensory is not that important. But if the sensory deficits are progressing, then it is dangerous. Progressing in what sense? Progressing in the quality of the numbness. That means patient is telling, no, yesterday it was 20% numb, now, you know, today it is around 30%, 40% numb, more numb than earlier. Or yesterday this much area of the numb, now this much of area, now this much of area, it is progressing in the size of the numbness, some size of the area of the numbness, or the quality of the numbness, both are dangerous. But if it is a fixed one, it is not progressing, then it is not red flag. So fixed numbness is not red flag, progressing numbness is a red flag. So first job of a pain physician is to rule out red flag whenever he is examining a patient of that pain. So what are those red flag? Just let us summarize again. So trauma, tumor, fracture, infection and neurodeficits. In the neurodeficits, autonomic, manifested in the form of the cortical syndrome, retention of the bladder and the constipations, unable to pass through, then motor weakness, then progressing numbness. So these are all the list of the red flags. Now the question is, somebody is coming and telling, okay, I am having excruciating pain, 10 out of 10 pain. Is it not a red flag? Is it a red flag? Tell, is it a red flag? Freelancism only we have discussed. The amount of the pain has no relation with issue. So, it is not a red flag, provided the conservative management has not failed. So, if the conservative management has failed, you cannot tell, okay, I am not going to do anything because you don't have any red flag, no? Because you know, you have learned the pain is not a red flag. Whatever point, the amount of the pain is there, I don't want to do it. So, do tell like that. If the conservative management has failed, then also it's there. So, first job is to eliminate a red flag. If red flag is not there, then how should manage this patient? It should be conservative. It should be going slow. How slow? You are facing a patient after 3 months, so you will be telling, okay, no, we don't have any red flag, so I'm not going to do it. Should we? No. Time limit is 1 to 1.5. So initial 1 to 1.5 months, whatever is the amount of the pain, we should try to manage it by conservative ways, provided there is no red flag. You should not jump into the interventions, you should not be thinking of the surgeries if the patient is not having any red flag in the initial 1 to 1.5 months. If this time is passed, even if there is no red flag, then you should be a little bit aggressive. Why? If we are allowing our patients to suffer from pain, what will happen? Sensitization, central sensitization, peripheral sensitization, then this pain will be very difficult to treat. So, we should not allow our patient to feel pain longer time, maximum 1 to 1.5 months. After that, you have to be aggressive. Even if there is no red flag, even then you have to be aggressive to treat the pain. Otherwise, if there is a stamp, I call it footprint. Monster came and went back, keeping its footprint on the nervous system, and that footprint might be very difficult to erase. So the permanent physiological changes might be there in the form of the sensitization, in the form of the central generalization, which might be very difficult to treat. So that is the reason why that we should not be waiting for long. 1 and 1.5 months, if no red flag, after that you should be thinking of something more aggressive, something intervention or something more to relieve the pain. But initial 1 month, we should be trying to treat this patient in a conservative way, like analgesics, like co-analgesics, depending on what type of pain it is. But very important part is we have to rule out red flags. See, if the red flag is not there, we should be conservative. Conservative management includes pharmacological and non-pharmacological method. Non-pharmacological means some simple exercise, sometimes in a hot or cold topic. So these are the things which are your non-pharmacological modalities. Along with that, depending on the type of the pain, we can give some analgesics or we can add some co-analgesics. This is the way we should treat. But if the pain is not relieved by 5 to 7 days, then it becomes red flag. Then you have to move like this. But if, fortunately, in 90% situations, we should be able to take care of the pain. So, first part when you are seeing a patient suffering from back pain with leg pain is to rule out. Next, what we'll be discussing? We'll be discussing few common conditions producing back pain. One of them is your facet.